Well, many of the deposits in the world that where you get palladium, you also get platinum and you also get rhodium. A big chunk of the mining of those minerals comes from Russia and South Africa, almost 80%. So that's the nature of where the deposits are found. That will affect pricing. When you've got risks associated with extraction, they sometimes cause those minerals or commodities to trade at a premium. So I think the pricing will remain strong.
Today's guest is a supporting sponsor of Liberty and Finance.
Welcome back to Liberty and Finance. We have a returning guest. Jim Paterson is the CEO of ValOre Metals Corp. He joins us this Thursday, July 15th, 2021. Jim, thanks for coming back on Liberty and Finance.
Dunnigan, thank you for leaving your conference to talk to me.
Well, it isn't exactly my conference. I happen to be attending the 2021 Natural Resources Symposium. I'm attending in the Miles Franklin Precious Metals Exhibitor booth. In fact, I was mentioning to you before we started the recording, one of the things we talked about with you last time we had you on Liberty and Finance was about platinum group elements, PGE, platinum group metals, and some of your mines and your exploration areas that are, in fact, promising multi-mineral, where that could be one of the minerals that is found there, but there are others. I was relating to you a phenomenon that's been happening. We've been talking to experts, including Jim Rawls, David Morgan, others who've been saying, and Maurice Jackson, saying for years now that platinum has a remarkable value story like silver does relative to gold in the current environment and has some catching up to do. I mean, historically, platinum, if you think about it from the Visa card, platinum is higher than gold and that sort of thing. In any colloquial situation, platinum always means like above gold. And in fact, platinum usually is priced above gold. Has been for the past, most of the past decade or two. But because of some manufacturing changes and so on, we've seen platinum at a discount to gold recently, and it still is. So it's got some catching up to do still. We've been talking about it as a value opportunity. And I mentioned to you that just in the past month here, we've had a special at Miles Franklin where we had these 1/10 ounce Britannia coins. These are the sovereign minted legal tender status coins coming out of Britain, the British Royal Mint, in pure platinum. And they've been going like hotcakes at like 15% over spot. And people have been just snapping those up. They can't believe that we're offering them at that low of a markup for a 1/10 ounce coin. It usually carries a pretty high percentage premium. So anyway, I was just telling you, as part of the what's going on with platinum story, could you please just bring us up to date briefly on your awareness of the platinum market and the platinum price movement and what's the major trend right there before we talk about specific exploration activities related to that?
Yeah, the platinum price has moved up. I'm not sure if it's doubled in the last year and a half, but pretty close. And just what you're talking about is sort of an on the street, man on the street note on the popularity of it and the usages of it. So I think that in terms of the industrial uses, a little more than half of the platinum, primary platinum usage is for catalytic converters in automobiles. That's obviously not your business at all. Your business is store of wealth, I guess, or as an investment. So that kind of flight to platinum might be arbitrage in many respects, where people say it's a store of value, gold's on a per ounce basis is trading at a higher price than platinum, we'll buy platinum. They're both very valuable. I think palladium is lesser known. And I kind of struggle with this too when I talk to people that are big supporters of our group and investors in our company, and we'll put a news release out on our drill results, and they'll say, I don't know what that means. In terms of platinum grades or drill hole intervals or assays, what does it mean? And I'll say to them, well, based on the pricing of gold, based on the pricing of platinum, based on the pricing of palladium, when we put a news release out, it can kind of average out that if you think this is a good gold assay interval, it would line up almost identically to a palladium platinum interval in our case, because the deposits that we have are roughly 60% palladium and 40% platinum. In terms of the pricing there, it kind of equals out. If you were using a rough rule of thumb, it's sort of the same value as gold. And that helps them understand, because a lot of investors in our space understand gold deposits really well. I think a lot of the exploration companies are looking for gold deposits, so they really educate their investor bases so people know that. And if people understand, well, palladium and platinum, you know, are roughly, palladium's trading at a higher price than gold, platinum's trading at a lower price than gold. And if you've got a deposit that's sort of half palladium, half platinum, then it kind of equals out roughly to the valuation of gold. So that's helpful for those investors that understand gold deposits.
Well, we've two thoughts that came to mind on that. One is we've had Rick Rule on several times talking about why palladium ran away in price, whereas platinum went kind of the opposite direction. And one of the discussions was that the industry, one of the main industrial applications of this, of course, being catalytic converters for both gasoline and diesel engines in auto manufacturing or truck manufacturing. And with platinum having been formerly higher priced than palladium, a lot of industry retooling happened to start favoring how they could use palladium, since it has similar elemental properties in many ways to platinum, for catalytic converters to save money. And then of course, there were some supply constraints at the same time as the increased demand. And so the palladium price ran away. And now it's flipped around. And Rick anticipates that industry being what it is, and I certainly came out of a 35-plus year background as a manufacturing engineer, know that you're always looking to value engineer your product, always looking to, you know, get the results out with putting less capital investment in, so and raw material costs as well. So that he's anticipating the industry will reverse that engineering decision, figure out how to go back to platinum most likely rather than palladium in catalytic converters going forward. And so we're likely to see increased industrial demand for platinum going forward. And then we had Maurice Jackson from Proven and Probable, different platform like mine. And he's talked about, well, some critics of that whole scenario we just described say, you know, internal combustion engines are the old economy. The new economy is electric vehicles. And he says, well, let's go down that road. He says the next generation of electric vehicles are likely to be fuel cell driven cars, because today's electric vehicles expect somebody else to be generating the power for them. Fuel cell cars, you know, having the fuel cell on board. And again, platinum is an ideal material for fuel cells. So anyway, no matter how you look at it, it seems like platinum has a bright future. And wanted to find out more about what the discovery and exploration progress has been on that. Again, big picture topic. We talked with Keith Neumeyer from First Majestic Silver, again with Rick Rule, talking about massive metals shortage coming. They're talking about the new electrified economy and how copper and a number of other metals, they mentioned, you know, cobalt, zinc, some other metals, and possibly platinum as well, are going to be required in greater and greater quantities in the new economy, yet exploration, discovery, and development and permitting and everything are lagging like at least a decade behind. Can you talk to us about, just briefly, about that big picture? Where does the whole industry for global production of platinum stand relative to what the projected demand is going to be?
Well, many of the deposits in the world that where you get palladium, you also get platinum and you also get rhodium, and all three of those minerals and some others in the PG complex are actually utilized for the auto industry. So for the most part, though, a big chunk of the mining of those minerals comes from Russia and South Africa, almost 80%. I'm not sure if you've seen any of the footage going on right now in South Africa, but I would say that there's a lot of jurisdictional risk happening right now in South Africa. There's a lot of unrest. And the dogma of the U.S. administration right now and how they're treating Russia, that I would say that there's some jurisdictional risk associated with doing trade with Russia. So that's the nature of where the deposits are found. And so I think that that will affect pricing when you've got risks associated with extraction. They sometimes cause those minerals or commodities to trade at a premium. So I think the pricing will remain strong. What you talked about in terms of substitution is very important. So as a general rule, I would say palladium is used for combustion engines, like for gasoline, and a lot of platinum is used for diesel engines, which is what you're talking about, truck engines. So I think that there could be some substitution, but it takes some time. I think it's like an oil tanker. The industry takes a couple of years to kind of make its turn. So, you know, if platinum prices continue to move up as they have, then probably there won't be as much of a push to substitute palladium for platinum if they're both trading at roughly the same pricing. I think if there's a huge arbitrage or difference between the two mineral pricings, you might say, why are we using palladium when we can use platinum? Let's retool and spend several years and hundreds of millions or billions of dollars in retooling our facility so that we don't have to use palladium anymore. We can use platinum. But as they move closer and closer in terms of pricing, I don't think the substitution will be a big deal. In terms of the hydrogen economy, you know, perhaps it's coming. I am 48 years old. When I started in the business, there was a company called Ballard Power that was talking all about the coming hydrogen economy, and that was in 1997. So I don't know when it's coming. I hope it does. And when it does, I'm sure it will have massive changes. I don't think, you know, the entire infrastructure of the global economy and manufacturing base and the industrialized economy changes overnight. There's a transitionary period that happens when it comes to turning from a 100% internal combustion engines to electric vehicles. I would argue that probably there'll be a transition, and that's happening right now with hybrid vehicles, where you have an electric vehicle that also has an internal combustion engine, and those types of cars actually utilize palladium and or platinum, depending upon what kind of petrochemical they're using. The uses are still there. Over the time period that ValOre holds this palladium platinum project, I think we're going to have gasoline cars. I don't think there's an issue. I think we're going to be able to move this project forward quickly enough that we'll still capitalize on a world that has cars that burn gasoline and thus need to reduce pollution and noxious gases. So they will need catalytic converters. My opinion, I may be wrong.
Well, this is an evolving situation, and we're wanting to keep an eye on it because it's very interesting. As you get enough vibrant debate between people talking about what way the technology and the key strategic minerals are going to be that are needed by the next stage of the economy, but then you get a whole nother layer on that debate when you talk about people saying, you know, we're off to the races with expanding commodity prices, or oh no, this was just a blip coming out of the COVID-19 lockdown, and now we're going to have stabilizing prices. This is just transitory hyperinflation or whatever. It's going to be an interesting next year here as we see how this is going to play out. A lot of eyes are on platinum, though, so we're going to keep our focus on that. You've got some news today that just came out, actually this week, on the 13th, with some notes on news releases from ValOre. One of the things that jumped out to me in the news release that you came out with this week as the CEO was the overall quantity of progress notes that are coming out in this first half of the year versus all of 2020. And it echoed to me the fact that you've already issued 20 news releases in the first half of 2021, which matches and now surpassing all of the news releases from the entire previous year, 2020. What it echoes for me is what we're seeing unfold in so many areas of our economic and financial lives. The people on our channel are watching the signposts of the times. They're seeing developments unfolding in our currency expansion, in our debt markets, in our financial equities markets, in all kinds of policy decisions by our governments in all jurisdictions. And they're seeing these signposts that we're passing faster and faster, it seems, rather than kind of like life being predictable and life being as it was before. It seems like things are happening faster. And even in my little corner of the world as a bullion dealer, including platinum selling, is that the level of volume is like between 3 to 6 times normal. Like Andy Schechtman, the CEO of Miles Franklin Precious Metals, said we did a full year's worth of business in just, you know, first four to five months of last year, and the same thing happening this year. So if you could talk to us about what is driving this increased volume and rapidity of this progress cycle, specifically for ValOre and for the platinum exploration that you do.
In 2020, at the beginning of 2020, we went to a conference called PDAC, which is in Toronto in March. And coming out of that, we had a plan that we wanted to execute, so we needed to raise money for that. And that's exactly when COVID was happening. And there was massive uncertainty about travel and we didn't know what was going to happen in Brazil. And because of that, but because we wanted to get things moving on the project, because we had the team ready to go, we had effectively agreed on terms with the drilling contractors, I lent the company money. And when I lent the company money, it allowed us to move forward in the project. But the reason why I did that versus raising equity is because I didn't want to sell equity or shares in the company to investors and then tell them a month later that due to COVID, we're so sorry, we're not going to be able to do any work. We'll have to shut down operations. So you've just given us money to do something, and now we're not going to do it. But over time, obviously, my ability to lend money to the company is just limited to my own finances and how mad my wife is going to get at me. So that probably wouldn't last long. So we were limited in terms of what we did, in terms of our productivity. What we saw at the beginning of 2021 is that we'd built a very loyal following out there in the investment community. We had a huge amount of interest. And so we went to the market and announced a financing. We ended up announcing a little over $3 million, and we raised over $8 million. And what we were able to do with some of that money is extinguish the line that I'd loaned to the company and bring in a whole bunch of new investors. Insiders still took down over 20% of the financing. And what that gave us was a bunch of capital to plan better, to add more tools to the toolkit in terms of drill rigs. We had not just diamond drill core rigs, but we had a reverse circulation rig, which is a faster, a little less accurate rig, but it's great to test rock types really quickly and efficiently. We have a whole bunch of auger drilling, and we have a full team. And that increased amount of productivity obviously generates a lot more news flow. And we're just getting a ton of work done, and all that work will generate assay results, which creates news releases. So we're going to see this back half of the year being even more active than the front half of the year. So I'm super excited about it. But yeah, I mean, in order to kind of really plan and be strategic, it's good to have financial resources. And in 2020, we were kind of hindered by the fact that we thought we didn't want to lay out our shareholders. And so I was willing to take that risk, but this year I didn't have to. So we got a lot more resources, and thus we'll have a lot more news flow.
One of the points you also, I didn't hear you mention just now, but is in your press release, was about management team additions. We've, again, I keep bringing him up. Rick Rule talks to us often about finding teams that have a proven track record of success, or people, management who have been serially successful. Can you talk to us about why you believe that the management team additions that you've made in the past half a year or so here are going to be strategically meaningful for ValOre?
Rick Rule would definitely know Darren Klink, and Darren Klink joined our board, and I was super honored by that. He was he's a really good longtime friend, but he was also president and CEO, and then president of a company called Bluestone, which is part of Discovery Group. And I was on the board with him. I was a director of Bluestone, and just amazing caliber of executive that is now on our board. So lots of international experience, lots of large company experience. He's had a tremendous amount of CSR experience of managing large groups of people and doing deals all over the world. And this guy is now on our board, Darren Klink. We promoted Colin Smith, the VP Exploration. He's been doing a spectacular job over the last year. We solidified the management on the ground in the form of Tiago Dinez, who is now running our exploration manager in Brazil. So he's managing a team of 8 people. And we added Ian Pritchard and then Luis Azevedo as advisors. So those guys collectively have a lot of engineering project experience, certainly Brazilian experience, legal experience, geological experience. And, you know, when you have people like that, pretty much anything you have to deal with, if you ask them the questions, they'll have dealt with it in the past and can give you insight as to how you might best deal with it. So we've done a ton of really great work this year in terms of building our team.
The other thing I wanted to ask you about was you mentioned in your press release, you talked about resource expansion drilling has been very successful. Can you tell us more about what resource expansion drilling means and why it is important to investors?
Yeah, for sure. And that's actually really the the critical thing that those that listen carefully can understand and determine whether they think they have an edge on others that don't take the time to understand this stuff. So we had, if you look at what forms a mineral resource, particularly an inferred resource, it's just a series of drill holes. And those drill holes may or may not hit mineralization. And let's say there's 10 drill holes and they're super widely spaced. So they're 100 meters in between all of them and they drill holes. That would probably be an inferred resource. So that means there's less certainty because there's less drilling density. So you know more, you know less about it, but you kind of have a broad idea. And so you have to kind of envision in your head like a pin cushion where the pins allow you to hypothesize on the size of the cushion, but the pin pricks aren't the cushion. They're just hypothesizing about the size of the cushion. So in our case, there were several holes that were drilled and we utilized those to create and form an inferred resource when we acquired the project in 2019. And since then we drilled another cushion or off the cushion. We didn't drill within the cushion. We drilled off the cushion and we hit mineralization in many of those drill holes. So what we did is we added knowledge outside of the footprint of the existing resource. And what we're hoping is that those will expand the size of the resource because they are drilled outside of the area that formed the resource or hosts the resource. They were mineralized, and we're hoping that that third party qualified person resource estimator will look at that and say, well, obviously this thing is a lot bigger than was first imagined. And when in the end, that's kind of how we're valued as a company. If we have 1 million ounces or if we have 5 million ounces, obviously we'll have a different valuation. Our resource base will be larger. So, you know, we're looking to grow and expand, and we've been successful in drilling holes that were mineralized outside of the existing resource. This year has been pretty good. Actually, last year we drilled a bunch of holes that were successful, more this year and more to come in follow-on drilling, hopefully in the back half of 2021.
You're using the visual metaphor of pins and a pin cushion. I couldn't help but think about the game of Battleship, where you have this grid and you try to different coordinates and say, I'm going to look here and look here. And sometimes you find, okay, there was a ship there. Now you wonder, now I'm very curious, how far does that extend? And you try to find areas around that to see if you also find more ships or more of that ship.
I never thought of that analogy, but it's actually a really good one. It's a really good one in terms of understanding of what's happening, because a lot of these things, you know, you will use geophysics, you will use soil sampling at surface to determine where you want to drill, but you really don't know what's there until you do drill. And then when you do drill, you're only getting a couple of inches of diameter, and from there you have to extrapolate what's around it. And what mineralization is around it. And that's why that they say that the more drill holes you have, the more certainty you will have, the better defined it is.
So another thing that you mentioned in your press release was about assay results. So of these drill holes that you've done, you've gotten some positive answers on some of them. Some you're still awaiting results on?
Yeah, we're waiting a lot of results coming from not only the diamond drill core, but the reverse circulation. And we're using augers right now, which are effectively, just imagine like a corkscrew that is wound into the ground, and then you pull out the rock. And then you sample, meter or certain portions of that rock that you've pulled out. In the case of what we do, we have it's almost like a lawnmower engine. And that lawnmower engine is spinning this auger down into the ground. And we can get between 7, 10, sometimes 15 meters. That's almost 45 feet below surface. But what it does is it allows us to understand what the rock type is. And then we can send that off to assay. And how that will help us in the future is that, you know, we have all of these indications at surface that we have prospective targets. The auger drill gives us that, you know, third information in the third dimension. And if we come back, we are in the right rock type and the thing is juiced, then we can come back and drill it with the RC rig or the core rig. And so that's been super effective. Last year, we only had a couple of drill rigs for 4 or 5 months. This year, we've got those two rigs again, plus another reverse circulation rig, which is actually quite fast and efficient, and then these augers. So we've got three times of productivity in terms of new exploration and potential discovery happening, which of course will generate more results.
I wanted to enter the technical zone with you pretty soon and get you to define a term that might be helpful for our viewers. But before we do, is there anything that we haven't discussed about your news release that you want to make sure that you leave in the minds of our viewers so they have a good grasp of what you consider the most important takeaways?
Yeah, mostly that we're a lot more productive this year. We're going to generate a lot more results. The best is yet to come in terms of results coming out from the company. I think that, you know, I don't know yet until that resource estimate is done, but I will say that we have drilled a lot of holes that are sitting outside the footprint of the existing resource, and we think we'll be able to add to that. We think that we're going to make discoveries that can be advanced, and we're doing our darndest to show that the asset base is considerably higher than we purchased a year and a half ago.
And again, the jurisdiction in which this asset that we're describing is located?
In northeastern Brazil, a palladium platinum project called Pedra Branca. We've got a ton of videos on our website talking all about it.
And one of the important aspects of that is a less volatile or less controversial politically jurisdiction than some of the others that you had mentioned, a lot of other resources are located in. So this is a favorable jurisdiction given the current environment.
Yeah, great work in there.
All right, now we'd like to enter the technical zone with you. Wish I had a hard hat to put on, because we like to put our CEOs on the spot and get you to educate us and our viewers on a technical term which we may or may not have understanding of, so we can be better informed and hear with better ears going forward. So the technical term I'd like you to field for us is the term step out. What are step out drill patterns, and why is that important?
They're very important, and it kind of ties into what I was just talking about in terms of expanding resources. So picture a line on a football field or a soccer field, those white painted lines along the field. And let's say that, you know, somebody drew a circle on the line and then walked 10 feet down that line or 10 meters and drew a little another circle, but kept on that line and then walked another 10 and another 10. And then kind of think of that in terms of a good analogy to see how we would drill a deposit, where we would drill and then we would walk 100 meters and drill more and then walk 100 meters and drill more. That drill rig continues to drill on that line. And so step outs can be brave or they can be not so brave. So let's say that you had drilled every 10 feet and then you decide to step out and drill 2 feet past the last drill hole you'd done. That would be not such a brave move versus stepping out 500 feet along that same line and testing on a hole there. And if you hit mineralization after stepping out 500 feet, that'd be a brave move. But if you were successful, then you could start waving your arms and saying, well, we drilled 5 holes along that line and then we stepped out 500 feet from the last drill hole. We hit mineralization here as well. Thus, the potential size has grown or expanded by that amount. Now, this is something that's probably, yeah, I think you talked about porphyries. You know, when you have a big, lower grade, massive mineral system, you can step out 500 meters or 1,000 meters and still hit mineralization. If you get a very, very, very high grade underground gold system, if you step out 1,000 meters, you're not going to be anywhere near the mineralization because they're narrow, they're high grade. You might step out 10, 15 meters or 20 meters and hope you hit something. So the nature of your step out is dictated by the type of mineralization you have or that you're chasing. So high-grade stuff is generally narrower mineralization. Thus, you're going to step out less. You're going to step out 15, 10, or 30 meters. A big, massive copper porphyry, you might be able to step out 250 or 500 meters, which is, think how long that is. That's, you know, 1,500 feet or something. That's a long ways away. If you still hit mineralization after stepping out that far, then you can say, holy cow, this system could be quite massive. We drilled a bunch of holes here and we stepped out this far and it's still there. A step out is looking where you had your drill hole, and how far do you move from that drill hole to test the system again? So it can be 5, 10, 100 meters. The further you step, if you succeed, the bigger gain you've made, because you've demonstrated the mineralization continues potentially, and that system is much bigger.
This is just fascinating to me from coming from a manufacturing engineering background, because I'm thinking about quality control testing or process control testing you do in how often you sample intervals, whether it's measuring values of key performance indicators within the quality, critical to quality measurements within the manufacturing line, or whether it's destructive testing you do on final product after. It's like, how often statistically do you need to sample to really say, I have a good handle on the extent of either a concern or you know, that everything is good. So here you're combining statistical methods together with geological understanding to try to come up with this best economic way of rapidly gaining and characterizing something that is largely unseen, but of which you can infer a lot of information and really decrease risk and increase the probability of understanding what's there by using judicious exploration. Fascinating.
Yeah, and just to that point, just so people understand, if it were a homogeneous coal seam that was very easy to understand and what we call well-behaved. So in that system, it can go for hundreds of miles. And if you hit it, you have a pretty good idea that in another mile, it'll still be there. Stepping out a mile between drill holes makes sense. In a high-grade, kind of confusing and complex gold system, if you hit a drill hole and then you step out 1,000 meters and you hit again, you would be dishonest in saying, oh, I hit here and I hit there, they're probably connected. You have to look at the system that you're dealing with and say, well, it there's some over there, we're going to have to drill a bunch of holes in between, we'll have to connect the dots here to understand what we found.
Jim, we want to put a link to your press release in the description of this video. We'll also include it in the email that we send out to all of our newsletter subscribers about this, so that they can read all the details that you have in there. Any final thoughts you'd like to leave with our viewers about either this press release or what you're looking forward to in the second half of this year?
A lot of news coming in the second half. Please join us. Sign up at valoremetals.com for our news releases and stay in touch with us. The best is yet to come, Dennigan.
Well, thanks, Jim, for coming back on Liberty and Finance. We've been speaking with Jim Paterson. He's the CEO of ValOre Metals Corp. Jim, thanks for joining us again here on Liberty and Finance.
Thanks, Dennigan.